Miramichi, MEI, is the largest city in northern New Brunswick, Canada. It is situated at the mouth of the Miramichi River where it enters Miramichi Bay. The Miramichi River Valley is the second longest valley in New Brunswick, after the St. John River Valley. Neighborhoods. The city of Miramichi was formed in 1995 through the forced amalgamation of two towns, Newcastle and Chatham, and several smaller communities, including Douglastown, Lodgerville, and Nelson. Also the local service districts of Norden, Moorfield, Chatham Head, and Douglasfield. The amalgamation also included portions of the former local service district of Ferry Road, Russellville, and portions of Sir Man Chatham Parish, Glen Elg Parish, and Nelson Parish. History. MIKMAQ and French communities. Long prior to European settlement, the Miramichi region was home to members of the MIKMAQ First Nation. For the MIKMAQ, Beaubears Island, at the junction of the northwest and main southwest branches of the Miramichi River, was a natural meeting point. Following the European discovery of the Americas, the Miramichi became part of the French colony of Acadia. About 1648, Nicolas Denis, Sieur de Fronsac, established a fort and trading post, Fort Fronsac, on the Miramichi. This establishment was apparently constructed on the north side of the Miramichi, at the forks of the river. According to W. F. Ganong, a Recollet mission was established in 1686 on the Miramichi, in Nelson, probably near Beaubears Island. Nicolas Denis' son, Richard Denis, was placed in charge of the fort and trading post, and in 1688 Richard states, "Miramichi is the principal place of my residence," and describes his establishment as including about a dozen French and more than 500 Indians. In 1691 Richard died at sea, the post declined. By about 1740 French villages were well established on Miramichi Bay at Bay du Van and Negwak. In the current city of Miramichi, a larger village existed at Canadian Point, and a town comprising 200 houses, a chapel, and provision stores occupied Beaubears Point. The French maintained batteries of guns at the east end of Beaubears Island and at French Fort Cove. French and Indian War. The French and Indian War erupted in 1754. During the war many Acadian homes were destroyed by the British, and their residents were deported. In 1757 the French general, Charles de Champs de Bichebere de Raffitot, attempted to evade British troops in the St. John River Valley and the Bay of Fundy, by leading 900 French refugees up the northeast coast of New Brunswick to Miramichi, establishing a camp, Camp de la Espérance, on Beaubears Island. After the siege of Louisbourg, Bechebet led a group of Acadians from St. Peter's, Nova Scotia, to Miramichi. Over 200 of the refugees died at the camp. On 13 August 1758, French officer Bechebet left Miramichi with 400 soldiers, including Acadians from Port Toulouse, for Fort St. George. His detachment reached there on 9 September but was caught in an ambush and had to withdraw. They then went on to raid Friendship, Maine, where British settlers were killed and others taken prisoner. This was Bechebet's last Acadian expedition. From there, Bechebet and the Acadians went to Quebec and fought in the Battle of Quebec. In September 1758, Colonel James Murray reported spending 2 days in Miramichi Bay during the Gulf of St. Lawrence campaign, looking unsuccessfully for Acadians, but destroying anything he found. This included burning the first stone church built in New Brunswick. Murray did not sail as far west as Beaubears Island. Most of the surviving Beaubears Island refugees soon left the Miramichi, seeking refuge in Quebec. Some Acadians, however, remained and escaped British attempts at deportation. They eventually established a host of small Acadian communities along the northern and eastern coasts of present-day New Brunswick. Scottish and Loyalist immigration. The French were defeated at Quebec and Montreal, and the remaining Miramichi settlement was subsequently burned to the ground by British Commodore John Byron in 1760. The French North American colonies were ceded to the British in the 1763 Treaty of Paris. The Miramichi thus became a part of the British colony of Nova Scotia, and later New Brunswick. Benjamin Marston, a surveyor and the first sheriff, reported in 1785 that a considerable French village had existed on Wilson's Point, although they were clearly preceded by the Mikmaq and Acadian peoples. Credit for the first permanent white settlement at Miramichi is often granted to Scottish settlers, led by William Davidson. William Davidson and John Court had obtained a large grant encompassing much of the Miramichi region in 1765, and promoted the area in both Scotland and New England as a new home to potential settlers. American Revolution and Battle at Miramichi. At the beginning of the American Revolution, the Mikmaq and Maliseet were supportive of the Americans against the British. They participated in the Margoville Rebellion and the Battle of Fort Cumberland in 1776. 3 years later, in June 1779, Mikmaq in the Miramichi attacked and plundered some of the British in the area. The following month, British Captain Augustus Harvey, in command of HMS Viper, arrived in the area and battled with the Mikmaq. One Mikmaq was killed and 16 were taken prisoner to Quebec. The prisoners were eventually brought to Halifax, where they were later released upon signing an oath of allegiance to the British Crown on 28 July 1779. After the battle, Davidson temporarily found refuge along the St. John River. A subsequent treaty signed 22 September 1779 ensured a more peaceful coexistence. Following the American Revolution, some Loyalist families moved to Miramichi. Davidson's original grant was revoked, and competition for the best lands escalated tensions between the early Scottish and new Loyalist settlers. Great Miramichi Fire of 1825. In 1825, a large forest fire, among the worst in recorded history of North America, devastated a number of communities in northern New Brunswick. Irish immigration. The Irish began arriving in Miramichi in numbers after 1815 at the end of the Napoleonic War and, with a few exceptions, ceased coming to the area before the Great Irish Famine of 1847. They came to the area voluntarily to better their lives. Contrary to prevailing belief, not all of them were Catholic, though very few Protestants among them identified openly as Irish, and most of their descendants in Miramichi do not do so even to this day. Most arrived from the ports of Belfast and Cork, each of which had strong commercial ties with Miramichi. Like the Scots, they came on timber ships as individuals or in small family groups, and the average age upon arrival was 24. There was some chain emigration whereby additional family members joined the emigrant later, but this was minimal. The Miramichi River Valley was not settled by large transplantations of Scottish clans or large-scale movements of starving and evicted Irish, though there are one or two interesting exceptions. In 1815, after trade had developed with Newfoundland, Miramichi was surprised and shaken by the arrival of the so-called two boaters, perhaps as many as 2,000. These were the Irish who had taken advantage of cheap fares to St. John's in the spring and summer of 1815. They were mostly poor labourers and farmers, and it seems that initially they settled mainly in the Chatham, Douglastown area, with no prospect of obtaining a land grant. Jobs in the woods or in the mills were the only means of getting established. Most of them were able to get at least temporary employment upon arrival, but it was short-lived. In 1819, a sharp decline in timber prices resulted in massive layoffs in Miramichi, including most of the two-boat Irish of the Chatham area. Following their grueling experience in St. John's and now unemployed, they became disenchanted by their newfound misery so many miles from home. They began to create disturbances in the village of Chatham. Violent outrages were committed in broad daylight, property was stolen, and in the worst cases houses and barns were burned to the ground. The people of the area soon dubbed then those uncivilized immigrants from Ireland, whom local magistrates were powerless to control. But the Irish were not the only troublemakers along the river at that time. They were often mistakenly blamed for outrageous disturbances caused by unruly sailors idling about the port during the spring and summer months. These idle sailors whooped it up at Miramichi, particularly on Sundays when the taverns were closed, but often the Irish got the blame. In 1822, a detachment of the 78th Regiment stationed in Fredericton was temporarily sent to Chatham to keep the peace, but it was not the soldiers of 78th Regiment who quieted the Irish. It took an improved economy, jobs and newfound opportunity to do the trick. The Loochowk tragedy, unlike the ports of Quebec, St. John, St. Andrews, Boston, Baltimore, Philadelphia, New York, Charleston, and New Orleans, Miramichi did not receive large numbers of destitute and starving Irish during the famine years. Fewer than four so-called coffin ships made it to Miramichi between 1844 and 1849 with less than 300 people on board. They were ships plying to Quebec with sick and dying passengers, stricken with cholera and other diseases. They diverted to Miramichi in desperation and on arrival were quarantined at Middle Island, where they were treated in appalling conditions. There was great fear of them, and some Miramichis, including the Irish, refer to them as " yellow mealers " believing all they had had to eat was corn. The arrival of the famine ship Loochowk on June 2, 1847, was a major tragedy at Miramichi. She left Liverpool for Quebec with 462 passengers on board. During the first 2 weeks at sea, more than 100 died of sickness, and the majority of the crew contracted severe fever and were unfit for duty. With only a few able seamen available to man the ship and few other options, the captain headed to the nearest port, Miramichi. When news of the dire conditions on board became known, she was forbidden by the port authorities to dock even at Middle Island. The captain could not get permission to land the sick and dying or to bury the dead for over 6 days, in which further severe anguish and the loss of 40 more lives occurred. The arrival of two more famine ships, the Richard White and the Bolivar, further exacerbated the problem. The authorities finally but reluctantly constructed temporary shelters on the island and allowed the sick passengers and crew to land. A further 50 or so people died in the makeshift facilities provided, including the young Chatham doctor John Vondi, who volunteered to stay full-time to administer to the sick and dying, and within a few days succumbed to the fever himself. The Irish in the 1870s and 1880s. By the 1870s, the Irish were well established in Miramichi, and by this decade less than 20% of them were recent immigrants. In total, they represented 40% of the population of the region, spread fairly evenly over the entire Miramichi watershed. 80% were Catholic, and only the upriver parish of Ludlow had a Protestant Irish majority. By the 1880s, they controlled 15% of businesses and professions in the town of Chatham, and probably the same number in Newcastle. However, the majority were still listed as skilled and unskilled workers. Industry and politics. Although subsistence farming constituted one part of the new settlement's economy, the thin, acid soils of the Miramichi were not conducive to agriculture, thus, the lumber industry and Atlantic salmon fishery were the mainstays. A shipbuilding industry was established by Davidson in 1773, largely to facilitate overseas lumber exports, including masts for the British Navy, and to provide winter employment for the men. Davidson's first ship, Miramichi, was lost with her cargo off the Spanish coast. Miramichi benefited greatly from the Napoleonic Wars and American independence, as Britain became dependent on its remaining North American colonies, including New Brunswick, for lumber. However, the Great Miramichi Fire of 1825, the advent of steel-hulled ships, and perhaps overcutting of eastern white pine, would eventually contribute to a long-term decline in the area's economy. The Miramichi fire burnt almost one quarter of New Brunswick's forest, and consumed most of the buildings along the northern side of the river. Only 12 buildings remained in Newcastle. The towns of Newcastle and Chatham developed a long history of rivalry, including a small war fought between the communities. The 1843 election was fought on a political level between John T. Williston of Chatham and John Ambrose Street of Newcastle. The Rankin and Cunard factions literally fought the election in the streets of Newcastle and Chatham with sticks, stones, coal and other missiles. Railway in 1875. The region's largest construction project in history was completed when the federal government's intercolonial railway opened between Moncton and Campbellton. The following year it would link Halifax with Rivière-du-Loup and the Canadian railway network. One of the biggest geographic obstacles presented in the project was the crossing of the Miramichi River. Surveyors deemed the ideal location for bridging to be at the upper reaches of tide water between Nelson and Newcastle. Crossing the southwest Miramichi, then a short section of land at Derby, followed by the northwest Miramichi. The combined length of these bridges would be among the largest constructed to date in Canada and were the first bridges over the Miramichi River, revolutionizing transport in the region. The ICR bypassed Chatham by running through Newcastle and then onto the north and west. Within a decade, the Canada Eastern Railway was built to link Chatham with Fredericton, along the length of the southwest Miramichi River Valley. In 1904, the Canada Eastern was purchased by the ICR. In 1915, the ICR became part of Canadian Government Railways and 3 years later in 1918 it became part of the Canadian National Railway. CNR operated express passenger trains along the main line from Halifax to Montreal via Newcastle, most notably the Ocean Limited, along with various local trains to Fredericton, Moncton and Campbellton. The Dungarvan Whooper provided passenger service along the Canada Eastern Railway from Newcastle to Fredericton. The ports and railways serving Newcastle and Chatham burgeoned with activity as the 19th century lumber industry gave way to the 20th century. Developments in pulp and paper, and mining. 20th century industry and politics as the shipbuilding, masting and lumber industries waned. Pulp and paper production eventually replaced lumber exports as the mainstay of the area's economy. A valuable sports fishery developed, attracting sports initially from adjacent New England, and subsequently from all parts of the world. In the mid-20th century, an Air Force-based CFB Chatham became the cornerstone of Chatham's economy. The discovery of base metal deposits and the development of Heath Steel Mines, 60 kilometers to the northwest, allowed Newcastle's economy to diversify and strengthen through the 1960s. The mine and Air Force Base had both closed by 1999 as the mine's ore body was depleted, and with the collapse of the Cold War, the forest industry is the dominant player in the city's economy today. In the 20th century, the rivalry between Newcastle and Chatham continued, expressed chiefly through sports, politics, and in competition for businesses and government largesse. In 1994, then Premier Frank McKenna developed and implemented a plan for merging the communities. The amalgamation of the former towns and villages to form the city of Miramichi was controversial at the time, and remains so today, due in part to the strong identities that each of the communities possessed. The 1995 amalgamation of the communities served to limit local rivalries, giving the region a larger and more united voice in promoting the region. In addition to this, many smaller communities in the Miramichi Valley felt that the name of the newly formed city was a threat to their tourism industry, and to their identity as Miramichi's economy. The Miramichi area's economy is primarily focused on mining, fishing and forestry. Other sectors include tourism, customer contact centers, manufacturing, and provincial and federal government. The service sector is the city's largest employer. The region has recently experienced the closure of several wood mills, causing many residents to migrate west. Since the shale gas boom in Alberta, many Miramichi residents split their time between the oil fields and Miramichi.